Hello, and welcome to my series of conversations with men and women whose ideas, vision, and philosophy help define our contemporary world. My guest today retired from the Indian Audit and Account Service as a Director General, but he spent a lifetime devoted to the study, promotion, understanding, and research of astrology. He's editor of the Journal of Astrology. He founded the astrology course at the Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan, and most significantly, perhaps 2 years ago in the Supreme Court, led the campaign for the recognition, the endorsement, as it were, by the judicial political establishment of astrology. I'm delighted to welcome Mr. K.N. Rao.
Thank you.
For you, astrology has been a sadhana too, not just a predictive science. What is the sadhana aspect of astrology? How do you use astrology as sadhana?
Well, let me tell you, astrology originated in the ashrams of rishis, and 18 rishis traditionally are said to be the founders of the system we follow. So from Gurukula, where shishyas went there to do their sadhana, astrology became part of the subject, but it is known as aparavidya, that it is not a spiritual subject, it is not a paravidya, it is an aparavidya. But an aparavidya which acts as a bridge between para and apara.
Explain to us aparavidya and...
Aparavidya, economics, politics, what we study in the university is apara. Paravidya is Upanishads, etc., Gita, which we study for spiritual knowledge and salvation. Astrology is a bridge. If you take the apara route, you become like any other astrologer making a fortune out of it. If you take the para route, it becomes part of your spiritual sadhana.
So in what ways do you use the aspects of astrology for your own personal spiritual growth?
You see, it is very well explained in one couplet of Kabir Das, Ram jharo ke baith ke jag ka mujra dekh. In other words, sitting on the attic of Ram Naam, see this weird dance of the world when people are motivated with their greed and selfishness. When you do astrology honestly, when people come to ask you a question, what do you see? All the time people involve too much in Maya. And you begin to take a detached view of the whole thing and ask yourself a question, is there no higher purpose in life? And once that becomes a pursuit of yours, then you know what to live, you know what to pursue.
You've been very emphatic about the role and uses of astrology, that they're not just predictive in the sense that, you know, can I use astrology to find out if I'm going to win an election, or can I use astrology to find out if I can make more money, or when I should sign a contract. It has this higher purpose, this higher meaning of life, as you've just described, that it is to understand, you know, the nature of Maya. Historically, astrology was also used as an adjunct to Ayurveda.
Yes.
In Banaras Hindu University, where astrology is taught as Ayurveda.
Yes, yes,
and astrology.
Yes.
You have done a great deal of research and work looking at the medical aspects.
You see, I'll tell you one thing. Medical aspect of astrology is a very deep subject. Only some doctors can do it properly. So far, I tried many doctors, but they learned astrology all right. They could not do good astro-medical diagnosis. Astrologically, we are able to warn a person about the coming period of sickness. We can also tell what will be the outcome of the disease. But the period in between, when the treatment is being done, when the patient is undergoing the treatment, what precisely will be the turn of events is difficult for us to predict. But astrologically, we are able to forewarn. That's a very big advantage. I have many, many instances of people whom I forewarn, be careful during this period, don't have any big plan because it's a period of sickness for you.
In a sense, the astrologer historically was also more than just someone who predicted. He was also a counselor to the community.
I'll put it this way, for a rough understanding, astrology is guidance, number one. It is used as a preventive, number two. Number three, it is counseling. And number four, it has a remedial aspect. These days, what has happened is the remedial aspect has got overemphasized because there is a lot of money. Mm-hmm. When astrologers have become mercenary, they want to make more money through remedial aspect. Mm-hmm. So, jocularly, I keep on saying there are very few Jyotishacharyas. Mm-hmm. There are more and more Upayacharyas now in the society.
Mm-hmm. Well, you personally don't charge or make any money from the practice of astrology at the Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan, a very prestigious institution recognized as amongst the largest astrological schools in the world. None of the teachers get paid. So how important, obviously, the motivation of the astrologer is extremely important.
You say motivation to predict, you mean?
No, the motivation to serve, with the motivation with which he approaches his
science.
Okay,
now this I will answer very easily by reminding you of a shloka of the Gita where Lord Krishna talks about the categories of bhaktas. Artha artharthi jigyasu jnani. Any subject when you study, particularly like astrology, you study as an artha, a man who is in agony. You want to understand the problem of your agony. For example, in one particular class of mine, out of nearly 32 students, 25 or 26 males were those who were tormented by their wives.
Well, the popular perception is it is usually
that is artha category. That is artha category. Artha category is those who want to make money out of it. That is a very large category now. Jigyasu. Now, for example, I predicted something about Delhi weather once, many years ago. Some people from meteorological department came and joined our classes only to know how astrologically we could do this prediction. Mm-hmm. That is jigyasa, curiosity of a scientist. Jnani, the fourth category. Well, it is part of my spiritual sadhana. So, those who are drawn towards astrology have to belong to one of the categories, artha, artharthi, jigyasu, jnani.
You know, you have been also working very hard for the scientific, empirical validation, in a sense, of astrology. At a personal level, you're believed to have something like 50,000 plus horoscopes amongst the largest private collections of horoscopes here. Right. Why do you think that astrology hasn't been exposed to the scientific rigor of analysis as medicine, for example, has been? Why this prejudice, this resistance to astrology?
First of all, when you decide to keep any knowledge as a secret knowledge, you cannot subject it to rigorous scientific discipline.
But is that desirable?
It is not desirable. I broke the shackles. Mm-hmm. I did it openly. I produced it. Mm-hmm. Childbirth, for example, cannot take place unless Saturn, Jupiter, Mars and Moon help parents. Mm-hmm. I have proven it in my book, Planets and Children, which has been tested on thousands and thousands of horoscopes in India, in USA, in Russia. Mm-hmm. So, giving it an empirical base, statistical empirical base, by testing it and showing the percentage of results, which should be done anywhere to establish the scientific validity of a subject. I'm the pioneer in that.
But sir, the question is that this is something that you have done.
Yes.
But as a practitioner of astrology and with the motivation of helping other people, but wouldn't it help the cause if this was also independently done as a subject of study and investigation as any other science is?
It will be done. It is being done slowly. See, after all, first to break a wrong tradition of too much of secrecy was a major battle. After doing that, now when we are doing this research, our students have been doing brilliant work empirically, statistically, and he is bound to come after 10-15 years, no one will question.
So what applications in terms of the public good can this kind of research have?
Yes, very good. First of all, these days, I am concentrating mainly on choice of education. And openly, I have challenged everywhere in the world, wherever I have gone, 100 educational psychologists cannot point out in 1 month what an astrologer can point out in 10 minutes by looking at the horoscope of a child and talking about his educational aptitude. We will never go wrong. 80% time will be 100% sure, 20% time because new subjects come into university curriculum. we have some confusion, but some slight confusion only.
But is it necessary to be an astrologer to provide this guidance? Can this become a model? Can there be, a computerized checklist?
No,
this becomes
it cannot
widely
come.
Accessible?
You have to know astrology only. Mm-hmm. You have to know astrology only, mm-hmm. and you have to have the courage to modernize those concepts. For example, mm-hmm. I will look into the horoscopes of many people. If I apply that 1,000 year old principle, mm-hmm. I will say you are studying Vedanta, mm-hmm. you are studying Nyaya, mm-hmm. Sankhya. They say we have nothing to do with it. The subject which made you study Vedanta 500 years ago mm-hmm. is now forcing you into management, MBA. Mm-hmm. The subject which made you study Nyaya many years ago is making you study journalism, mm-hmm. mass media. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So all these variations that come into play, mm-hmm. introducing modern concepts, mm-hmm. this only educated men can do. I have the advantage of having highly educated people as our student. Mm-hmm. It is not the old Pandit style.
You're watching a conversation with the editor of the Journal of Astrology, an eminent astrologer himself, K.N. Rao. We'll be right back after a short break. Don't go away.
Keep preparing.
Iron fist.
Challenging assignment.
Demands of peace.
Velvet glove.
Different roles.
When you see the pictures, you may also wish to know more about their world in the sun, rain and snow. So, in this program, we will bring you an insight into the world of men in uniform and developments that affect them and all of us, both in times of war and peace.
Welcome back to a continuing conversation with the astrologer and professor, founder of the School of Astrology at the Bhartiya Vidya Bhavan, K.N. Rao. You in the Supreme Court 2 years ago, in a sense, led the lone battle on behalf of astrology to a challenge against the decision of the University Grants Commission to introduce astrology and as a course in universities, and there was this debate about whether it should be a science or a humanities subject. I think few argued that it is a part of our heritage and needs to be studied. That was a poignant victory for you, a kind of validation by the establishment, much of which who perhaps sort of, secretly were consulting people such as yourselves in any case. Yeah. But now this became an institutionalized, the Supreme Court of India says this is legitimate. You had two strands in your argument. Tell us about those.
You see, I'll tell you briefly. Under the directive principles of state policy, astrology could be very easily defended as a part of the composite culture of the country. Then, spreading scientific temper, that was the objection raised by scientists. There also we could defend by showing the statistical, empirical researches, etc. Now, when the argument arose, one of the unfortunate arguments giving a political twist to the whole thing was that astrology, Jyotisha, was saffronizing the education system. Then I became very angry and I showed them historical evidence. Timur Lang was named so on astrological consideration. His descendant Babur, when he came to India and was going to fight Rana Sanga, he consulted an astrologer of Persia. Of course, that prediction went wrong historically, but he consulted. He found Hindu astrology as far, far superior, so he asked his own son Humayun to learn astrology, and Humayun was an excellent astrologer who made historically two great predictions about himself. Mm-hmm. One, that if he married Hamida Banu, mm-hmm. she would become the mother of a world famous personality, and we know he was Akbar. Mm-hmm. Second was, he would win back the kingdom of India and become emperor again. Sher Shah Suri was defeated, mm-hmm. and he did become.
Was this a tradition of astrology in the Islamic tradition that was different than what the Hindu
slightly,
tradition was?
Slightly, yes, slightly different. And Hindus have been very, very liberal in their good old times. They adopted a system of astrology from the Muslim tradition also, which we call Tajak, annual horoscopy, which gives excellent results. Mm-hmm. So there was slight differences, all right. They borrowed our system, some of our features, and we borrowed only fragmentarily from them.
In what ways has the evolution of astronomy and science and more reliable calculations impacted modern astrology as compared to ancient astrology?
Yes, in ancient astrology, the calculations given were excellent, that is known as the Surya Siddhanta. Then what is known as Bija Sanskaran, modernizing the whole thing, that they could not do. In the meantime, NASA came out with its own observations, and Hindus have been very liberal and scientific in their outlook. We accept those calculations and use that for our predictive purposes.
Has that in fact you think made astrology today more accurate than it was in the past?
Well, I will not say it made it more accurate, because Ainansha correction, what you call, we have been doing it all through the centuries. So I will not say it had made more accurate, but I will say yes, it has made a significant difference in our calculation of certain astrological points.
And what about things like the demotion of Pluto from a planet?
You see, we never use Herschel, Pluto, Neptune in Hindu astrology at all. So the demotion or promotion or elevation or divinization makes no difference to Hindu astrologer.
But if modern science were now to decide that a particular planet that you use doesn't exist, Rahu, Ketu, how do they become notional planets? Physical planets?
Instead of saying notional or actual planets, let us first of all understand one thing very clearly, which most of these people don't understand, those who are attacking astrology. We use the word graha, not planet. What is a graha? The graha in the horoscope is that symbol which shows purva janma karma, that is the deeds of past life and its results. Now when in Padma Purana you read Raja Dashrath went to Shani Loka, requested Shani not to torment when after entering Rohini. So Shani said, I am a graha. Grahan, my duty is to catch, but since you are a dharmic raja, religious man, I'll not torment you much.
What is the logic of astrology? In what ways do planets impact the human personality, the biochemistry of the brain? In what ways do they act themselves out? In popular explanation at all, the moon affects the tides, and so the planets affect the biochemistry of the brain, and so there is a predisposition in some ways.
You see, I'll put it this way. If you want to understand astrology, roughly divide it into first Ganita, second Phalita. Phalita is predictive astrology. Phalita again you divide into two parts. One is known as Samhita, where we called mundane astrology, we make predictions about weather, about nations, about wars, collectivities. Then the Hora astrology, individual. An individual comes to me, wants to know what happened. Many things happen in his life which he cannot explain, which nothing else in the world can explain except astrology. Now, you will understand it in the Gita 18th chapter, Lord Krishna explains it to Arjuna. You do any planning, all these things, but there is a fifth element, adhisthanam tatha karta karanam cha prithak vidham vividha cha prithak chesta daivam cha atra eva cha panchamam. There is a fifth element always, that element of uncertainty, daiva, destiny. And it is also explained in the Valmiki Ramayana by Lord Rama to Lakshmana. So that fifth element of uncertainty, which we call daiva, is known only through astrology. That is why one of the synonyms for an astrology is daivagya.
Then this, it's the perennial debate between predestiny, karma, and free will.
Yes.
How does astrology, in its predictive form, so-and-so is going to happen, the person you say is going to be in the cricket team is going to win an election. What are the elements? Where is free will acting? Where is this aspect of destiny?
Well, all my simple answer to this is, remember three paths. First path is prarabdha, predestination. Second is purushartha, you have to keep on making efforts. Third is pa prarthana, your prayers. Mm-hmm. Pa, pa, pa. All the three have to go simultaneously. Mm-hmm. How does predestination come into play? Mm-hmm. I will give you one instance I came across recently. Nearly 24 years ago, I had warned a man. Mm-hmm. I had told him, don't get too much attached to your children. Mm-hmm. You will be very unhappy. Mm-hmm. Now his children have grown up. Mm-hmm. They have deprived him of all his property. In his mm-hmm. old age, the man is sitting alone in the house, almost mm-hmm. like a pensioner, mm-hmm. living on the charity of his children. He was unhappy. Mm-hmm. He came to me. Mm-hmm. Should he go to court of law? Mm-hmm. I said, even if you go to court of law, win. Mm-hmm. You'll not have enough time left to enjoy it.
Mm-hmm. You're watching a conversation with Mr. K. N. Rao, editor of the Journal of Astrology and the founder of the School of Astrology at the Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan, published more than 30 books on astrology. We'll be right back after a short break. Don't go away.
Metro Scan. Headlines from the four metros, Delhi, Chennai, Kolkata and Mumbai, delivered at your doorstep. Stay in touch, stay informed. Watch Metro Scan Monday to Friday, only on DD News.
Welcome back to a continuing conversation with astrologer K. N. Rao. Do you sometimes feel a sense of power? Isn't there a risk that if not in your case, certainly in astrology, amongst astrologers, that through astrology they know things about people, they're able to predict things, a sense of ego comes into play? Isn't that a great risk for an astrologer?
It is a terribly bad risk. Many of the astrologers who have this ego are generally those who know very little astrology.
And you
Vidya dadati vinayam. The more you know astrology, the humbler you must become.
Mm-hmm. What is it that breeds this humility? The insight into Maya that you had mentioned?
Yes. Humility, because once you begin to unravel the mysteries of planets, of grahas, you begin to realize you know so little mm-hmm. of the world, of the universe. Mm-hmm. But there is one thing very great. The meaning and purpose of human life, mm-hmm. you cannot understand better except through astrology. Mm-hmm. Jyotish is a pratyaksha shastra, demonstrable. Why is this happening to me? Someone says, I can explain astrologically. But if you do not know astrologically, sorry, I cannot explain scientifically. But either you accept or do not accept what I am saying. Mm-hmm. But if you know astrology, you can very clearly see why things are happening the way they are happening. Mm-hmm.
So, you know, you've used the phrase the meaning and purpose of life. What has astrology taught you to be the meaning and purpose of life?
Well, what has astrology taught me?
In terms of the meaning and purpose
of
life.
The meaning and purpose of human life is to serve humanity and devote your time to divinity, mm-hmm. pursuit of the spiritual, mm-hmm. and there is nothing else. Mm-hmm. All other things you can see, they come and vanish and go away. Mm-hmm. The Maya, the fickleness of human fortunes, mm-hmm. you can see, very easily see, pratyaksha shastra. Mm-hmm. So astrology gives you detachment, mm-hmm. jnan, vairagya, ishwar, pranidhan, mm-hmm. as they say in Patanjali Yoga Sutra. Mm-hmm. All the three are given only by astrology, mm-hmm. very easily. Sitting at home when you are working on horoscopes, mm-hmm. some divinity begins to flash before you, mm-hmm. and you begin to understand mm-hmm. that certain pursuits are totally useless, mm-hmm. certain pursuits are very useful. Mm-hmm. In any case, the man must have mm-hmm. a higher purpose available always in life mm-hmm. to rise above the pettiness of the world, mm-hmm. of which he is a part, in which he lives. Mm-hmm. In other words, Padma Patra Iva Ambhasa Gita. Mm-hmm. Born in the world, mm-hmm. live like a lotus. Mm-hmm. That is born out of the mud, but above the level of the mud.
In what circumstances would you urge people that it be appropriate and useful to visit and consult an astrologer?
These days, I will tell people not to visit an astrologer at all.
Why is that?
For mm-hmm. a very simple reason, the astrologer must turn you into a fatalist to make money. Mm-hmm. It has become so exploitative. Someone must fight this also. Mm-hmm. But
have you thought of, you have certified doctors, you have certified healers in so many professions. Have you thought of, is there a move in some ways, because anyone can, you know, read two of your books and decide they're an astrologer.
That is what is happening.
So is there some movement amongst astrologers to legitimize, to protect
well,
your reputations?
Well, part of the HR, University Grants Commission scheme to introduce astrology in the universities was also this, that was the aim. So in over a period of time, it will get legitimized. Then you will have to take license. It must become a licensed profession. Then when an astrologer cheats, you can drag him to a consumer court as you can drag a doctor.
That
must happen to prevent that evil.
You learned astrology when you were just 12 years old from your mother.
Yes.
And you've had many masters, from mantra gurus to Jyotish gurus. How important in your life, in the study of astrology, has been that spiritual dimension? For people who are going and studying astrology in universities, it's much more mundane.
It's in the books and details.
And that metaphysical transmission of insight and knowledge is no longer happening.
That's a beautiful question. That is kept as a secret. It is not revealed in any book of astrology. It is only with sadhus, seers. Fortunately, I had a yogi as my astrology guru, Yogi Bhaskaranandji. He would take up a horoscope and clearly show when obstacles were coming in the spiritual life, which you call antaray in the language of the yoga, or which you call Indra Utpat, Indra ka Utpat. That is how Vaishnavas describe it. When in the spiritual path some sort of temptation will come, you will get deviated, and what are the chances of coming back to that path? For example, one simple thing. A particular combination will show the man will have lot of temptations and woman will come into his life, the story of Vishwamitra, and finally he will overcome it. When will it happen? How will it happen? How will he overcome? All this we can see astrologically. Even in a spiritual path, those obstacles which are springing up.
So is astrology then suggesting the probability that it will happen?
I will not say probability, I will say near certainty. And I have seen that happen. And people have overcome that.
So in terms of, apart from your study, do you have a personal sadhana, a practice, a meditation, a prayer, independent of the study of astrology that has a bearing on
astrology? Yes, I am an initiated disciple of Swami Paramananda Saraswati of Bengal, who is no more. And I am a Krishna worshipper. I am attached to Vrindavan. So I do my sadhana. For me, my sadhana is more important, not astrology. But astrology, well, it has continues as a tradition, so I am doing astrology. But I am not dependent on astrology. I don't need astrology. For me, the more important thing is my sadhana.
And in terms of the unfolding of your sadhana and your work as an astrologer, in a sense, even though you continued astrology, you were with the Indian audit service, you retired as a director general. So in a sense, this is a sort of another incarnation for you, where you're focusing on this aspect of your life. What aspirations do you have for your journey ahead?
Well, the students we have in Bharati Vidya Bhavan with their high educational background, IAS, IPS, engineers, doctors, etc., all of them, if they continue the scientific tradition of astrology, after 20, 30, 40 years, astrology will be remembered all over the world as the science of future, as the science of sciences. That is the prediction I am giving.
And what would you like Mr. K. N. Rao to be remembered as?
Well, whether anyone remembers me or not, doesn't matter at all. It is the divine instrumentality chosen by God, an instrument. So that divine will work through me. I go away, someone else comes and does it. So why should I be anyone remember me? I have no eye on any mortality or immortality.
Thank you very much.